Good afternoon. This is All India Radio. I am Valsa Williams and with me is Rupinder Kaur Chawla with the Midday News. The headlines. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his Italian counterpart Giuseppe Conte to hold virtual bilateral summit today. In Bihar, all arrangements are in place for polling in third and final phase of state assembly elections tomorrow. Chief of Defence Staff General Bipin Rawat says India will not accept any shift in the line of actual control with China. Country's COVID-19 recovery rate reaches 92.32%. And in IPL cricket, Royal Challengers Bangalore to take on Sunrisers Hyderabad in eliminator match in Abu Dhabi this evening. As the nation fights the COVID-19 pandemic, we begin with a message of precaution to stay safe and protected by following these three simple steps. Wear a face mask, maintain 2 gaz ki duri for social distancing, focus on hand and face hygiene. And now the news in detail. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his Italian counterpart Giuseppe Conte will hold a virtual bilateral summit today. The summit will give an opportunity to the two leaders to comprehensively review the broad framework of the bilateral relationship and exchange views on major regional and global issues of mutual concern. Our correspondent reports that several government-to-government and private sector agreements or MOUs are under finalization and will be concluded on this occasion.
India and Italy share a warm and multifaceted relationship based on strong historical ties, common democratic traditions, rule of law, and a shared goal of international peace and stability. Italy is India's fifth largest trading partner in the EU after Germany, Belgium, the UK, and France. Bilateral trade stood at €9.52 billion in 2019. Around 600 large Italian companies are active in India, covering varied sectors such as fashion and garments, textiles and textile machinery, automotive components, infrastructure, chemicals, energy, confectionery, and insurance. Several Indian companies are also active in Italy. With Dipendra Kumar, Suparna Sejja, IIR News, Delhi.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi has said with the help of technology and modern processing solutions, India will soon emerge as an agriculture export hub. Chairing the virtual Global Investor Roundtable last evening, Mr. Modi said recent reforms in agriculture opened up new exciting possibilities to partner with the farmers of India.
Our recent reforms in agriculture open up new possibilities to partner with the farmers in India. With the help of technology and modern processing solutions, India will soon emerge as an agriculture export hub.
The Prime Minister said a strong and vibrant India can contribute to stabilization of the world economic order. He said we will do whatever it takes to make India the engine of global growth resurgence. He said India is the place if investors want returns with reliability, demand with democracy, stability with sustainability, and growth with a green approach. The virtual Global Investor Roundtable was organized by the Ministry of Finance and National Investment and Infrastructure Fund. It is an exclusive dialogue between leading global institutional investors, Indian business leaders, and the highest decision makers from the Government of India and financial market regulators.
Home Minister Amit Shah has appealed to all to bring back the lost heritage and glory of West Bengal. After offering prayers at Dakshineshwar Temple in Kolkata, the Home Minister told the media that this was the land of great spiritual leaders like Sri Chaitanya Dev, Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Vivekananda. He said West Bengal was the hub of spiritual awareness. The people of the state should take the responsibility to restore its heritage and glory. Mr. Shah said that he has visited Dakshineshwar a number of times and the auspicious place has been a source of inspiration. The minister was accompanied by Union Minister Babul Supriyo, BJP National General Secretary Kailash Vijayvargiya, Party Vice President Mukul Roy and State Unit Chief Dilip Ghosh, along with other prominent office bearers. Mr. Shah is presently on a 3-day visit to the state since Wednesday. In Bihar, all arrangements are in place for the third and final phase of state assembly elections. In all, 78 constituencies spread over 15 districts including Kishanganj, Katihar, Madhepura and Supaul, will go to polls in this phase tomorrow. Polling for by-election to Valmiki Nagar parliamentary seat will also be held simultaneously. 7 candidates are in play for this Lok Sabha seat. Over 2.35 crore electorates will decide fate of 1,204 candidates, including 110 women, in this phase. Polling will be from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. Chief Electoral Officer H.R. Srinivasa said polling will be held up to 4 p.m. in 4 Naxal-affected constituencies of Valmiki Nagar, Ramnagar, Simri Bakhtiarpur and Maheshi. Out of 33,782 polling stations, 4,999 are considered as vulnerable. Additional Chief Electoral Officer Sanjay Kumar Singh said that additional security forces have been deployed in Naxal-infested areas to ensure trouble-free polling.
78 Vidhan Sabha क्षेत्र निर्वाचन में जा रहे हैं उसमें से 4 Vidhan Sabha क्षेत्र रहते हैं जहां की मतदान सिर्फ 4 बजे तक होगा ये हैं वाल्मीकि नगर रामनगर सिमरी बख्तियारपुर और महिषी यहां 4 बजे तक चुनाव होगा बाकी जगहों पर 6 बजे तक चुनाव होगा.
Our correspondent reports that the Election Commission has instructed to follow COVID protocol during the conduct of elections.
Every person has to wear face mask during the election-related activities. Thermal scanning of all persons will be carried out and sanitizers will be made available at all locations during polling. All polling booths will be sanitized. In view of COVID situation, 1,000 electors will exercise their right of franchise at each polling station instead of 1,500. BJP is contesting on 35 seats while Janata Dal United 37, Vikas Shil Insan Party VIP 5 seats and Hindustani Awam Morcha 1 seat in this phase. While RJD is contesting 46 seats, Congress has fielded 25 candidates and left parties 7 seats. On the other hand, LJP has fielded 42 candidates, RLSP 23, BSP 19 and NCP 31 candidates for the final phase. Political fortune of Assembly Speaker Vijay Kumar Chaudhary and Chief of Vikasil Insan Party VIP Mukesh Sahni will be decided in this phase. 12 ministers including Vijendra Yadav, Bima Bharti and Ramesh Visidev are also in the fray. Krishna Kumar Lal, AIR News, Motihari.
Elections are being held in 3 phases for 243-member Bihar Legislative Assembly. The first and second phase of polling was held on 28th of October and 3rd of November. Counting of votes will be taken up on 10th of November.
Chief of Defence Staff General Bipin Rawat has said that border confrontations and unprovoked military actions spiralling into a larger conflict cannot be discounted. Speaking at a webinar organised by the National Defence College today, he said India will not accept any shift in the line of actual control with China.
The situation along the line of actual control in eastern Ladakh remains tense, and the PLA is facing unanticipated consequences of its misadventure in Ladakh because of the Indian Defence Force's firm and strong response. Our posturing is unambiguous. We will not accept any shifting of the line of actual control. In the overall security calculus, border confrontations, transgressions and unprovoked tactical military actions spiraling into a larger conflict cannot therefore be discontinued.
General Bipin Rawat said as India grows in stature, security challenges will also rise proportionately. The Chief of Defence Staff asserted that the country must move out of the constant threat of sanctions or dependency on individual nations for military requirements. He said the country is investing in building long-term indigenous capability for strategic independence to squarely meet present and emerging challenges.
In the emerging security paradigm, the armed forces should therefore be structured in a manner that they provide operational flexibility to pursue wider strategic objectives as well as resource optimization. Thus, foremost amongst the reforms is to adopt the integrated theater command system, which has the potential to unlock critical core strengths within the three services, bridge limitations and complement each other's competencies in battle to realize the full potential of our combat power in a synergized manner.
Referring to Pakistan, he said the new Indian template to deal with terror has injected uncertainty in that country, which was continuing its proxy war through cross-border terror. Army Chief General M.M. Narvane was conferred the honorary rank of General of the Nepali Army by President Vidya Devi Bhandari in Kathmandu yesterday. Following the ceremony, General Narvane called on the President of Nepal and discussed measures to further enhance bilateral cooperation. In Jammu and Kashmir, one terrorist was killed in an encounter with security forces in Pampore area of Pulwama district this morning. Police sources said a joint team of security forces launched a cordon and search operation in Lalpura village last evening following the intelligence inputs about the presence of terrorists in the village. As the security forces approached the spot, the terrorists fired upon them, and in the ensuing gun battle, one terrorist was killed. The identity of the slain terrorist is being ascertained. One local terrorist also surrendered during the encounter. Meanwhile, the joint operation was underway in the area when reports last came in. Further details are awaited.
You are listening to the Midday News on All India Radio. A reminder of the headlines before we move on. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his Italian counterpart Giuseppe Conte to hold virtual bilateral summit today. In Bihar, all arrangements are in place for polling in third and final phase of state assembly elections tomorrow. Chief of Defence Staff General Bipin Rawat says India will not accept any shift in the line of actual control with China. Country's COVID-19 recovery rate reaches 92.32%. And in IPL cricket, Royal Challengers Bangalore to take on Sunrisers Hyderabad in eliminator match in Abu Dhabi this evening. For quick news update round the clock, follow us on our Twitter handle at AIR News Alerts.
The Union Government today said the country's recovery rate among the COVID-19 patients has reached 92.32%. More than 54,000 COVID patients recovered during the last 24 hours. The total number of recoveries has reached over 77,65,000. The constantly increasing recoveries have ensured that the actual caseload of the country is reduced and currently comprises only 6.19% of the total positive cases. Presently, the total number of active cases in the country is 5,20,000. The ministry said 10 states and union territories account for over 78% of total active cases in the country. Maharashtra has the highest number of active cases with over 21%, followed by Kerala with 16%, Delhi 7.8%, West Bengal 6.87% and Karnataka 6.76%. In the last 24 hours, 47,638 new cases were reported, taking the total number of positive cases in the country so far to over 84 lakh. Currently, India's case fatality rate is at 1.49%, which is one of the lowest globally. In the last 24 hours, 670 deaths were reported, taking the toll to 1,24,985. According to Indian Council of Medical Research, more than 12,20,000 tests were conducted during the last 24 hours. The total number of samples tested so far has reached over 11 crore 54 lakh.
In Madhya Pradesh, the situation relating to coronavirus pandemic is constantly improving. The state's recovery rate has reached 94%. At the same time, the number of active cases is continuously decreasing. The number of active patients in the state is 7,756. More from a correspondent.
In Madhya Pradesh, 53% of the patients of corona are in home isolation. These patients are being monitored through command and control center. In hospital, 17% of the patients are on oxygen support. The maximum 180 cases have been reported in Bhopal, 65 in Indore, 57 in Gwalior and 33 in Jabalpur yesterday. The situation is continuously improving everywhere. The situation is most improved in Burhanpur and Khandwa districts. There are only 7 active patients in Burhanpur and 25 in Khandwa. Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan has asked the officials to ensure that no private hospitals should charge more fees for treatment from corona patients and they have to charge only prescribed rate by the government. Sanjeev Sharma, AIR News, Bhopal.
In Telangana, 1,602 new cases of COVID-19 have been reported during the past 24 hours. With this, the total COVID cases in the state went up to 2,47,284. The state conducted about 47,000 tests yesterday. The recovery rate reported at 91.65%, with 982 more people recovering yesterday. This took the number of recovered people so far in the state to 2,26,646. Meanwhile, the daily bulletin issued by the State Medical and Health Department this morning stated that total deaths rose to 1,366 following four more people succumbing to COVID and comorbidities during the past 24 hours.
The Andhra Pradesh government is going ahead with multi-pronged strategy to control COVID-19. When the state government has ramped up its health infrastructure to test and trace aggressively and provide timely treatment, Andhra Pradesh is testing at least 70,000 to 80,000 for COVID daily. Thus, early testing in the state has helped to maintain a low mortality rate. A record number of over 84.27 lakh samples have been tested in the state so far. New 2,745 more COVID-19 positive cases were recorded when tested, at least 85,364 samples in the state during the last 24 hours. 2,292 persons recovered and were discharged from various COVID hospitals in the state during the past 24 hours. The News Services Division of All India Radio and its bilingual live phone-in program tonight will bring you a special discussion on COVID-19. Senior physician Dr. Manoj Kumar will participate in the discussion. This can be heard on FM Gold channel and additional frequencies from 9:30 p.m. onwards. Listeners can ask questions to the expert on toll-free telephone number 1-800-115767. One can also ask questions on telephone number 011-233-1444 and post queries on our Twitter handle at AIR News Alerts by hashtag AskAIR.
University Grants Commission, or UGC, has issued guidelines for the reopening of universities and colleges across the country. As per the new guidelines, universities and colleges outside containment zone can be opened in a phased manner after consultation with the respective state and union territory governments. The guidelines have been vetted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and approved by the Ministry of Home Affairs and the Ministry of Education. The UGC has suggested smaller class sizes to enable social distancing. However, teaching hours in a day can be extended as per the institution's requirements. The new guidelines have asked the institutions to ensure that before reopening of any campus, the central or the concerned state government should have declared the area safe for reopening of educational institutions. The directions, instructions, guidelines and orders issued by the central and state government concerned regarding safety and health in view of COVID-19 must be fully abided by the higher educational institutions. Education Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank has urged educational institutions, students, parents and all those associated with the education world to ensure compliance with these guidelines for the survival and bright future of themselves and others.
In a major boost to the tech industry, the government has done away with most of the registration and compliance requirements that will facilitate permanent work from home for companies. The Department of Telecom has done away with the registration requirements for other service providers, OSPs, altogether, and the BPO industry engaged in data-related work has been taken out of the ambit of OSP regulations. Requirements such as deposit of bank guarantees for static IPs, frequent reporting obligations, the publication of network diagram, penal provisions, etc. have also been removed. Similarly, several other requirements which prevent companies from adopting work-from-home and work-from-anywhere policies have also been removed. Prime Minister Narendra Modi said these steps will further flexibility and productivity. In a tweet, Mr. Modi said his government is committed to furthering ease of doing business and making India a tech hub. The Prime Minister said India's IT sector is our pride and the prowess of this sector is recognized globally. The Prime Minister said the government is committed to do everything possible to ensure a conducive environment for growth and innovation in India. He said the move will especially encourage young talent in the sector. Electronics and IT Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad said this will boost the IT, IT-enabled services, BPO industry and create a friendly regime for work from home in India. Environment Minister Prakash Javdekar has said that the Union Government is taking all steps to combat air pollution in Delhi and North India. He said all possible technological interventions will be put to use towards combating air pollution. Mr. Javdekar informed that the commission set up by the Union Government for Air Quality Management will be chaired by Mr. M.M. Kutty.
Sabko saath lekar aur aaspaas ke padosi kshetron ko aur rajyon ko bhi saath lekar. उत्तर भारत में जो प्रदूषण होता है और खासकर दिल्ली और नजदीक के शहरों का जो एयर शेड है उस एयर शेड के प्रदूषण को मात देने के लिए आवश्यक उपाय और कार्रवाई ये आयोग करेगा।
Petroleum and Natural Gas Minister Dharmendra Pradhan has invited OPEC member countries to invest in India, especially in the efforts to transform the country into a manufacturing hub, which will be at the heart of global value chain. The minister co-chaired the fourth high-level meeting of the India-OPEC Energy Dialogue yesterday, along with Secretary-General of OPEC Secretariat, Mohammad Sanusi Barkindo. Talking to the virtual meeting, Mr. Pradhan urged OPEC countries to take a deep look at the rapidly changing global oil and gas sector due to COVID-19 and revisit the ongoing exchanges so that energy challenges, particularly in the oil sector, can be jointly addressed. He also reiterated Prime Minister Narendra Modi's appeal of not letting a purely economic agenda define globalization and also stressed on the need for a consumption-led energy demand recovery, oil price affordability for the long-term sustainability of crude oil markets and enhancing energy access. He expressed confidence that OPEC and India will continue working closely for mutual benefit and shared prosperity. The government of Karnataka has entered into an agreement with Tata Technologies to upgrade 150 government ITIs at a cost of 4,636.50 crore rupees. The agreement was signed in the presence of Chief Minister B.S. Yediyurappa in Bengaluru today. Along with Tata Technologies, about 20 other companies are contributing 4,080 crore rupees from the CSR funds for this program. The remaining 657 crore rupees will be provided by the state government. Each ITI will be upgraded at the cost of 30 crore rupees each. More from our correspondent.
According to the agreement, the ITIs being upgraded will be able to provide industry 4.0 based training that will fetch better employment opportunities to the ITI skilled students. It is expected that more than 1 lakh youth will benefit every year. Chief Minister B.S. Yediyurappa has said that government industry partnership will enable youth to have an excellent skills based on industry demands. The Deputy Chief Minister, Dr. C.N. Ashwath Narayana, has said that 10 new courses are being initiated based on the demands of the industries. There are 1,713 ITIs in the state, out of which 270 are government. Around 1.8 lakh students are skilled in ITIs every year in the state. Sudhindra, AIR News, Bengaluru.
In Maharashtra, Shivaji University in Kolhapur has taken a lead in developing a UV 360 sanitizer module robot. Higher and Technical Education Minister Uday Samant said the robot, now kept at Nagpur, will play an effective role in disinfecting the places which are usually crowded by people. He said students who are interested in the field of robotics will get further inspiration because of this innovation. Our correspondent has more details.
The COVID-19 pandemic saw various technological advancements to fight the battle against the disease. Now, even as the research is being carried out on sanitizing tunnel and UVC torch, the inception of UV 360 sanitizer module robo will play an important role in this fight against COVID-19. Various types of sensors and artificial intelligence are the main features of this robo. The PIR sensor detects human movements and immediately stops emission of ultraviolet rays. Also, to protect it from colliding with any hard object in the room, anti-collision sensor has been fitted into it. To measure the area that should be disinfected, an LIDAR sensor has been installed in this robo. The robo, which weighs 20 kg, can disinfect a 100 square feet room in less than 5 minutes. Besides, the 18 UVC tubes of 11 watts helps not only in destroying the virus of COVID, but others as well. With Kunal Shinde, Madhuri Pange, AIR News, Mumbai.
Uttarakhand Chief Minister Trivendra Singh Rawat has instructed officials to ensure piped water connection to all schools and Anganwadi centres by December end. During a review meeting of Jal Jeevan Mission in Dehradun, the Chief Minister termed it an important project and asked the concerned district magistrate to keep a regular watch on this project.
In Assam, Bongaigaon District Administration has initiated Mission Sampoorn in a bid to improve the health condition of the malnourished children. Deputy Commissioner Dr. Lakshmi Priya said that the program was started during the Poshan Maha in the district. The Mission Sampoorn initiative is not only to improve the health of the malnourished child, but also to achieve the dream of women empowerment. She informed that there are 2,500 malnourished children in the district, and within a month of launching this project, health condition of 10% of these children has already improved. In the cliffhanger presidential election in the United States, Democrat candidate Joe Biden is leading by securing 253 electoral votes so far, whereas incumbent president and Republican candidate Donald Trump stands at 213 electoral votes. In the 538-member electoral college, the candidate needs to secure at least 270 electoral votes to be declared as a presidential election. Counting of votes is still going on in few key states like Pennsylvania, Arizona, North Carolina, Nevada, and Georgia, which will determine the outcome of the U.S. election. As per the latest update, Democrats are leading in Arizona and Nevada, whereas Republicans have maintained their lead in Pennsylvania, Georgia, and North Carolina. However, the lead in two key states of Pennsylvania and Georgia is less than even 0.5%.
In Indian Premier League cricket, Royal Challengers Bangalore will take on Sunrisers Hyderabad in the eliminator match in Abu Dhabi this evening. The winner of the fixture will meet Delhi Capitals in the second qualifier, scheduled to be played at the same venue on Sunday. In the first qualifier last night, defending champions Mumbai Indians thrashed Delhi Capitals by 57 runs to reach the finals. Sent into bat first, Mumbai Indians made a massive total of 200 for 5 in 20 overs. In reply, Delhi finished on 143 for 8 in the allotted 20 overs. In tennis, India's Rohan Bopanna and Austrian Oliver Marach have entered the men's doubles quarterfinals of the Paris Masters. The unseeded Indo-Austrian pair came from behind to defeat 9 seeds Fabrice Martin and Jean-Julien Roger in the round of 16 tie. Indian-Austrian duo will face the 8th seed pairing of Edouard Roger Vasselin and Jürgen Melzer in the quarterfinals today. And now let us take a look at the weather update for the day. The national capital will see mist. The temperature will hover between 14 and 31 degrees Celsius. In Mumbai, sky will be mainly clear. The lower level of temperature in the metropolis was 23. Upper level will be around 32 degrees. Chennai is to see a thunderstorm with rain. Temperature will hover between 25 and 33 degrees. Kolkata is expected to have a clear sky with temperature varying between 20 and 32 degrees Celsius. On to the north in Jammu and Kashmir, Jammu and Srinagar cities will have a mainly clear sky, but there will be much variance in temperature in Srinagar as the minimum temperature was 0 degrees Celsius, while maximum will be around 20 degrees. In Jammu, lower level of temperature was 12 degrees Celsius, while upper level will be around 29 degrees. In Leh, sky will be partly cloudy in the afternoon and evening. Minimum temperature was minus 3 degrees Celsius, while maximum will be around 10 degrees. Gilgit will also see a clear sky with temperature hovering between minus 1 and 24 degrees. In Muzaffarabad, sky will be mainly clear. Temperature will move from 7 to 28 degrees. In Dehradun, temperature will hover between 12 and 29 degrees. City will have a mainly clear sky. Chandigarh will have a mainly clear sky too, with temperature oscillating between 11 and 30. In Hyderabad, minimum temperature was 16 degrees. Maximum will be around 32. Ahmedabad will see a clear sky with minimum temperature 18, maximum around 33. Patna will see a clear sky with temperature hovering between 14 and 31. In Guwahati, temperature will hover between 19 and 32 degrees. And now before we end the bulletin, the headlines once again. Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his Italian counterpart Giuseppe Conte to hold virtual bilateral summit today. In Bihar, all arrangements are in place for polling in third and final phase of state assembly elections tomorrow. Chief of Defence Staff General Bipin Rawat says India will not accept any shift in line of actual control with China. Country's COVID-19 recovery rate reaches 92.32%. And in IPL cricket, Royal Challengers Bangalore to take on Sunrisers Hyderabad in eliminator match in Abu Dhabi this evening. And with that, we end the midday news.